The Guild is excited to offer you a new and different style of painting tutorial today. We have three different members painting three different dragons. Myself, Carl from West Coast Bannerman, is painting up Drogon in a very simple fashion with a dry brush and glaze technique. Then we have Yannick from Tabletop Warden, who has done an amazing job making the veins on the wings pop by using layer after layer. And last but definitely not least, we have Daryl from Northern Realms Gaming painting Viserion with an airbrush start along with beautiful blending as well. In this video, your eyes will enjoy a step-by-step of our approach to each dragon, but your ears will hopefully enjoy a reading of book lore provided by myself all about dragons. We'll start with a reading of the back of the unit box, Mother of Dragons, by Kulmanirnaut's Song of Ice and Fire tabletop miniatures game. The Mother of Dragons. Queen Daenerys Targaryen, the Mother of Dragons, is a living legend, the most powerful woman in Essos and possibly the world. She commands legions of unsullied, thousands of mercenaries, and rules the free city of Meereen. But in addition to her mighty deeds and wise rule, she also commands the dragons Rhaegal, Viserion, and Drogon. These deadly beasts dominate any battlefield with Daenerys in command, and should their mother take the field, her commands lend human intelligence to their raw cunning and sheer ferocity. In conflict after conflict, Daenerys Stormborn's legend continues to grow.
It is an excerpt from The Rise of Valyria in the World of Ice and Fire. In such fragments of Barth's unnatural history as remain, the Septon appears to have considered various legends, examining the origins of dragons and how they came to be controlled by the Valyrians. The Valyrians themselves claim that dragons sprang forth as the children of the 14 flames, while in Qarth, the tales state that there was once a second moon in the sky. One day this moon was scalded by the sun and cracked like an egg, and a million dragons poured forth. In Ashai, the tales are many and confused, but certain texts, all impossibly ancient, claim that dragons first came from the Shadow, a place where all of our learning fails us. These Ashai histories say that a people so ancient they had no name first tamed the dragons in the Shadow and brought them to Valyria, teaching the Valyrians their arts before departing from the Annals. Yet if men in the Shadow had tamed dragons first, why did they not conquer as the Valyrians did? It seems likelier that the Valyrian tale is the truest, but there were dragons in Westeros once, long before the Targaryens came, as our own legends and histories tell us. If dragons did first spring from the 14 flames, they must have been spread across much of the known world before they were tamed. And, in fact, there is evidence for this, as dragon bones have been found as far north as Eve, and even in the jungles of Sothorios. But the Valyrians harnessed and subjugated them as no one else could.
Let's take a look at a most intriguing section from A World of Ice and Fire, found within the section named 10,000 Ships. At Siloris, he won his first battle, overwhelming a Valyrian army 30,000 strong and taking the city by storm. Balasar met the same fate. At Volon Theris, Garen found himself facing 100,000 foes, 100 war elephants, and 3 dragon lords. Here, too, he prevailed, though at great cost. Thousands burned, but thousands more sheltered in the shallows of the river, whilst their wizards raised enormous waterspouts against the foes' dragons. Roynish archers brought down 2 of the dragons, whilst the 3rd fled, wounded. In the aftermath, Mother Rhoyne rose in rage to swallow Volon Theris. Thereafter, men began to name the victorious prince Garen the Great, and it is said that, in Volantis, great lords trembled in terror as his host advanced. Rather than face him in the field, the Volantines retreated back behind their black walls and appealed to the Freehold for help. And the dragons came. Not 3, as Prince Garen had faced at Volon Theris, but 300 or more, if the tales that have come down to us can be believed. Against their fires, the Rhoynor could not stand. Tens of thousands burned, whilst others rushed into the river, hoping that the embrace of Mother Rhoyne would offer them protection against Dragonflame, only to drown in their mother's embrace. Some chroniclers insist that the fires burned so hot that the very waters of the river boiled and turned to steam. Garen the Great was captured alive and made to watch his people suffer for their defiance. His warriors were shown no such mercy. The Valentines and their Valyrian kin put them to the sword, So many that it was said that their blood turned the great harbor of Valentis red as far as the eye could see. Thereafter the victors gathered their own forces and moved north along the river, sacking Sarmale savagely before advancing on Croyane, Prince Gurin's own city. Locked in a golden cage at the command of the Dragon Lords, Garen was carried back to the festival city to witness its destruction. We will now fast forward in time to Aegon's conquest. It is said that Harren spat at that and returned to his castle. Once inside, he sent every man of his to the parapets armed with spears and bows and crossbows, promising lands and riches to whichever of them could bring the dragon down. "Had I a daughter, the dragon slayer could claim her hand as well," Harren the Black proclaimed. "Instead, I will give him one of the Tully's daughters, or all three if he likes, or he may pick one of Blackwood's whelps or strongs or any girl born of these traitors of the Trident, these lords of yellow mud." Then Harren the Black retired to his tower surrounded by his household guard to sup with his remaining sons. As the last light of the sun faded, Black Harren's men stared into the gathering darkness, clutching their spears and crossbows. When no dragon appeared, some may have thought that Aegon's threats had been hollow. But Aegon Targaryen took Beleriand up high, through the clouds up and up until the dragon was no bigger than a fly upon the moon. Only then did he descend well inside the castle walls, on wings as black as pitch. Beleriand plunged through the night, and when the great towers of Harren Hall appeared beneath him, the dragon roared his fury and bathed them in black fire, shot through with swirls of red. "Stone does not burn," Harren had boasted. But his castle was not made of stone alone. Wood and wool, hemp and straw, bread and salted beef and grain, all took fire. Nor were Harren's iron men made of stone, smoking, screaming, shrouded in flames.
They ran across the yards and tumbled from the wall walks
to die upon the ground below. And even stone will crack and melt if a fire is hot enough. The river lords outside the castle walls said later that the towers of Harren Hall glowed red against the night like five great candles. And like candles, they began to twist and melt, as runnels of molten stone ran down their sides.
Let's turn our attention now to a Game of Thrones, the very last chapter, the Daenerys chapter. I'll read the final excerpt. "Only death can pay for life." And there came a second crack, loud and sharp as thunder. And the smoke stirred and whirled around her, and the pyre shifted, the logs exploding as the fire touched their secret hearts. She heard the screams of frightened horses and the voices of the Dothraki raised in shouts of fear and terror, and Ser Jorah calling her name and cursing. No, she wanted to shout to him. "No, my good knight, do not fear for me. The fire is mine. I am Daenerys Stormborn, daughter of dragons, bride of dragons, mother of dragons. Don't you see? Don't you see?" With a belch of flame and smoke that reached 30 feet into the sky, the pyre collapsed and came down around her. Unafraid, Dany stepped forward into the firestorm, calling to her children. The third crack was as loud and sharp as the breaking of the world. When the fire died at last and the ground became cool enough to walk upon, Ser Jorah Mormont found her amidst the ashes, surrounded by blackened logs and bits of glowing ember and the burnt bones of man and woman and stallion. She was naked, covered with soot, her clothes turned to ash, her beautiful hair all crisped away, yet she was unhurt. The cream and gold dragon was suckling at her left breast, the green and bronze at the right. Her arms cradled them close. The black and scarlet beast was draped across her shoulders, its long, sinuous neck coiled around her chin. When it saw Jorah, it raised its head and looked at him with eyes as red as coals. Wordless, the knight fell to his knees. The men of her cowls came up behind him. Jogo was the first to lay his arak at her feet. "Blood of my blood," he murmured, pushing his face to the smoking earth. "Blood of my blood," she heard Ago echo. "Blood of my blood," Rakaro shouted. And after them came her handmaids, and then the others, all the Dothraki, men and women and children, and Dany had only to look at their eyes to know that they were hers now, today and tomorrow and forever, hers as they had never been Drogo's. As Daenerys Targaryen rose to her feet, her black hissed, pale smoke venting from its mouth and nostrils, the other two pulled away from her breast and added their voices to the call, translucent wings unfolding and stirring the air. And for the first time in hundreds of years, the night came alive with the music of dragons.